Thank you, Elsa and Fredrik, for this opening chat. Dear SIF participants, heartily welcome to this 7th Stockholm Internet Forum. I'm truly happy to know that we have all gathered, so many have gathered for this important event. It's an important event. It's important to interact and reach out to people in times of isolation and in times of crisis, because many of us live through isolation and many of us live in crisis. This event has managed to gather many hundred, maybe up to 1,000 participants registered from all corners of the world. Welcome. We see Stockholm Internet Forum as a way to bring organizations and people together to mobilize for a free, open, and secure internet for all. And you are all at the core of that mobilization. You are really the experts and the ones making change happen. Many of you have already started the conversation participating in the workshops organized by you, our partners at Pre-SIF on Friday and earlier today. I'm hoping, or rather I'm sure, that the energy from the workshops will feed into this main SIF program starting as of now. SIF has a long history, but this is the first SIF taking place exclusively online. We have had the ambition to create a space that offers a chance to reflect and regain energy, to get new ideas, new ways forward. But we have all become familiar with the concept of screen fatigue over the last year. And therefore, I really want to encourage you all to take part also in activities such as yoga and co-creation in addition to the other sessions. Around the time of the first Stockholm Internet Forum, some approximately 10 years ago, we established that human rights apply online the way they do offline. Over the last years, Stockholm Internet Forum has focused on the theme of access and power in 2017 and shrinking democratic space online in 2019. This is an illustration of the developments of the world and, of course, of the internet. This year's theme is yet again another illustration of development, and this year's theme is mobilizing for digital resilience, a free, open, and secure internet in the shifting landscape of the pandemic. The pandemic has creating, or is creating rather, a new situation where existing inequalities across all levels of society have grown. In light of the pandemic, it has become clear that we are globally intertwined by the challenges we face. The pandemic has made existing disparities acutely visible from the individual to groups of people, as well as between countries and regions. We see disparities in the ability to mobilize resources to respond to multiple crises brought on by the pandemic. This includes areas like robustness of public information services, health services, the presence and strength of social safety nets, and whether to prioritize the opening of the economy over lockdowns. SIF creates an opportunity to learn from each other and understand how to build resilience with technology to better cope with the pandemic and future crisis. The global lockdown has put focus on our reliance on digital and networked infrastructures for work, intimacy, care, pleasure, solidarity, autonomy, and public participation. Having access to trusted information has become a matter of life and death. This also requires having the needed devices and skills to reach a level of meaningful connectivity. The risks and negative impact of being left offline have grown and exist on a global and unprecedented scale. During the pandemic, we have seen how technology can impact human rights online through tracking applications and surveillance technology. We have seen the use of algorithms to promote or demote online content. We need to continue discussing internet regulation. content moderation and financial drivers of surveillance technology. We want multi-stakeholder participation in such a discussion and have aimed for SIF21 to be a platform for dialogue on ongoing proposed regulations and resolutions. Organizations, activists, and media representatives have been subject to increased restrictions on freedom of movement and freedom of expression. It has become more difficult for people to exercise and defend their rights. SIF is a way for us all to continue build a movement to defend and protect the democratic space online, and thus also defend the democratic space offline. Firmly based on the notion that human rights apply online the way they do offline, Stockholm Internet Forum offers a platform to explore the protection of human rights, ways to combat gender-based violence online, and strengthen digital security and safety. We will, during the days, share knowledge and experiences, and most importantly, identify effective responses to these challenges. The pandemic has, as we all know by now, affected women and girls particularly hard. The large and persistent gender gap in terms of access has consequences for livelihoods and access to services. It also means not having access to vital health information, and online attacks against women human rights defenders are increasing. Gender-based violence, online and offline, is a priority area of work, a priority concern for SIDA. During the last years, we have seen how concerns about women human rights defenders' exposure to gender-based violence in the online space have gained wide policy recognition, and many of you here today are the reason for these successes. I would like to extend a big thank you for your contribution in this process. As we gather here now, a little over a month before the Gender Equality Forum in Paris, following up on the Beijing Platform for Action, we see Stockholm Internet Forum as an opportunity to mobilize in the call for further action by both state and non-state actors in this field. The internet has provided increased freedom and opportunities never before seen in history. It has allowed many of us to move activities online when faced with a pandemic and when faced with lockdowns. In this digital age, development and poverty reduction is inherently intertwined with access to the internet. We see more and more examples of how technology can change livelihoods for the better. Whether it is using big data to trace crop production from producer to consumer, or using crowdfunding to fund solar installations for renewable energy, for example, across the African continent. Living through the pandemic and the layers of crisis has affected all of us across geography and across other kinds of differences on the globe. This means that existing structural inequalities across all levels of societies also have grown. But, and this is an important but, I want to remind us all that times of crisis can also be the time to shape a new reality. Crises sometimes come with opportunities. We stand firmly committed at SIDA, and I think that we all stand firmly together, all of us having gathered here today. But at SIDA, we stand firmly committed to building forward better, greener, and fairer. Together, we will use today and the next 2 days to learn from each other, create new networks, and formulate strategies to build digital resilience and human resilience for all. And this is, of course, for today and for the future. We will find joint solutions to the many problems facing the online space, but also keep a focus on the opportunities it offers. In short, We will mobilize for a rights-based, free and open internet as a driver for development. With these words, I would like to once again welcome you all to the Stockholm Internet Forum. And with great pride, I would like to introduce the next speaker, the Swedish Minister for International Development Cooperation, Mr. Per Olsson Fridh. The floor is yours, I was about to say that.
Thank you, Carin. It's an honor to be here to, together with you, start off this conversation with all of you today here at the 2021 Stockholm Internet Forum. And I'm proud that Sweden that we are able to provide this important platform, and that it's also an opportunity to mobilize for future action. For example, I also understand that two UN special rapporteurs will be organizing consultations during the Stockholm Internet Forum, one on gender and on freedom of expression, and the other on climate defenders. And this is absolutely fantastic, I think. This year's theme, mobilizing for digital resilience, reflects the reality of today and how it's no longer possible for anyone to ignore the need to ensure that everyone has access to open, free, and secure digital technologies. The pandemic has, whether we like it or not, forced us to take a leapfrog into the digital world. It has taught us important lessons about the possibilities that digital technologies bring, but also exposed the deep digital divides that exists. Our focus now must be to recover, to build back or forward, greener and better, and to transition into a fairer, more equal, more sustainable world. And I'd like to highlight three areas that are important when talking about mobilizing for digital resilience and development. First, the internet as a democratic space. Second, connectivity and access. And last, the need for more cooperation. So the first one, we must highlight the importance that the internet has had for democracy. The internet and digital technologies enable us to communicate, to access information, to engage in democratic processes, and enjoy our human rights. This has in many ways led to positive effects, such as democratic development and participation, as well as combating oppression. Emphasizing the benefits of the internet and strengthening respect for human rights online is a priority in Sweden's drive for democracy, an initiative that permeates our foreign policy. But at the same time, however, and as we know, we see how some states use this current situation as a pretext to restrict access to internet and enjoyment of human rights, such as freedom of expression, information, or privacy. State surveillance and persecution of human rights defenders, silencing of journalists and media workers, and attacks on political dissidents on the internet is increasing globally and has been exacerbated by the pandemic and the increased amount of repressive legislation and regulation does not only limit free expression, but also people's ability to fully participate in society. And this is not acceptable. Response measures to mitigate the pandemic must be in full accordance with international law and place gender equality, human rights, democracy, and rule of law at its core. And for this, it is crucial that the internet remains open, free, and secure. Second, this pandemic has revealed the deep digital divides that exist in this world. Large parts of the world have gone through a digital transformation, enabling us to work from home, continue our education, and access medical and healthcare systems. At the same time, those who do not have internet access have fallen even further behind, resulting in even larger inequalities. The fact that 3.7 billion people still have no access to the internet is not good enough. This has consequences for how people can participate in political decisions, gain access to information, as well as gain access to markets. But the digital divide also exists within countries where too often women do not have digital access to the digital technologies to the same extent as men. It's therefore of absolute necessity that when we recover and rebuild from this pandemic, we must ensure that no one is left behind and put women also at the core of these efforts. Sweden is ready to do its share. Bridging the digital divide has been a priority for many years, and we are intensifying our efforts. And I'm especially proud of our support in increasing women's access to technologies, women as entrepreneurs in tech, and tackling gender-based violence by creating a safe online environment for women and girls. Third, to my final point, and I want to echo the Secretary General, that we need to connect, respect, and protect all people everywhere. Therefore, we need global cooperation and multilateralism to work on more digital connectivity and digital transformation. All measures relating to the development of the framework, content and common standards of the internet must take place through multi-stakeholder cooperation, where states and civil society and private sector are included. States, because they must ensure the full respect for human rights online. Companies and private sector, because they are instrumental in maintaining the democratic space, must also respect human rights. And civil society, of course, because they play an important role as watchdogs, monitoring potential violations and abuses of human rights. Sweden is a proud member of the Freedom Online Coalition, which, with its advisory network, is one important example of multi-stakeholder cooperation. And I know that many of you are represented here today. To conclude this, new technologies already serve as an important tool for sustainable development, democracy, and human rights, addressing climate change and fighting corruption. We must embrace technology and utilize its potential. Swedish Development Cooperation is now including technology in more programs ever before, and I expect this trend to continue and do so better than those who try to use it as a tool for surveillance and repression. Sweden will continue to prioritize digital issues and be active with our voice in all relevant fora, including in the EU and in the UN. And I hope that you all in the next few days will participate in rewarding discussions that will bring us one step closer to a more democratic and sustainable digital future. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Carin Jämtin and Per Olsson Fridh, for those inspiring words.
And now we're looking forward to our very first panel here at SIF21. The opening panel will be going to the heart of the matter of why we need to talk about tech and the role of the internet and technology in building resilience, especially in the landscape of the pandemic.
And we will hear Irene Kahn, Special Rapporteur on the Promotion and Protection of Freedom of Opinion and Expression, Per Olsson Fridh, Minister for International Development Cooperation, Helani Galpaya, Chief Executive Officer at LearnAsia, and Joan Carling, Global Director, Indigenous Peoples' Rights International.
The session is moderated by Jack SM Key. Jack is a feminist activist working at the intersection of internet and technologies, social justice and collective power, based in Malaysia. Welcome.
Hello. I think I might be live, so I'm just going to go with it. It's a little bit disconcerting. We are kind of like in our own little spaces. Hello and welcome to the Stockholm Internet Forum opening plenary. My name is Jack, and as introduced earlier, I am a feminist tech activist based in Malaysia and recently a co-dreamer and co-funder of Numun Fund. It's raining right now, so you might be able to hear it pitter-pattering in the background. And I really, first of all, appreciate everyone being here for this opening plenary. It's really difficult times in different and uneven ways across the world. And I just want to take a moment to recognize the huge challenges that's taking place right now in India, in Brazil, the protests in Myanmar, Colombia, and what's currently taking place in Palestine, and all of the different struggles and resistance taking place in different parts of the world. So I really, really appreciate everyone's presence here. And to be able to be here together to think through where and how digital technologies intersect against the shifting landscape of the pandemic and how they continue to impact our lives in so many ways is really critical. And so this panel is to open up this year's SIF against the question of mobilizing for digital resilience. What does technology have to do with building resilience at this time of a global pandemic? And we will discuss this through the four thematic areas of SIF21 around meaningful access, rights, resistance and solidarity, internet governance and regulation, and finally, resilience, the economy and the environment. And we have four brilliant discussants with us for this conversation, and they are already introduced, so I won't have to go into it very much deeply again. So we have Irene Khan, Special Rapporteur of Freedom of Expression, Pierre Olsson Fridh, who is the Minister for the International Development Cooperation, Helani Galpaya, Chief Executive Director of Learn Asia, and Joan Carling, Global Director of Indigenous Peoples' Rights International. So, let's start with access. And access really in the last year has become the intermediary to so many facets of life. Even for someone like me who's been working remotely for more than a decade, I found it really challenging because everything is intermediate through the internet, no? Like work, information, health, intimacy, even food. I have never ordered as much food as I have online before in my life. And I know I also recognize that that is a huge privilege as well. And meaningful access is really much more pronounced than ever. And yet the reality is still not that much different from 2019. Almost 50% of the world is disconnected. And within that, of course, there is a gender gap. And within that, even more forms of diversity. So the first question, I think, let's open up with Joan. No, your work involves in advancing the needs of a diversity of Indigenous peoples, many of whom live in places far away from technology infrastructure. Has access been an issue? And what has the impact been? I think you're muted. You might have to unmute. Yeah.
Sorry. Yes, definitely. It's a big issue for Indigenous peoples, especially in this time of the pandemic. To begin with, we have 476 million Indigenous peoples across the world, and 70% are living in rural areas, majority of which do not have internet connectivity. So you can just imagine during the lockdown, the kind of isolation that they have, where they don't have communication facilities and information, source of information. If you look at the extent of the pandemic now, it has really exacerbated the inequality that was already pre-existing before the pandemic. So the highest death, for example, are in the US and in Brazil. And many of them are indigenous. And these are in the remote areas. That means, for example, US has the facilities, right? They would have been prevented if only the information of what's happening in indigenous territories are properly communicated and action were given to them immediately, right? Mm. And also in the situation of resilience, for example, it has been a tradition of indigenous peoples to have this system of cooperation in times of disaster. But because of the pandemic where lockdowns are imposed, communities cannot anymore exchange whatever crops or food they have. So because that's a form of support, no? And they cannot communicate in terms of some cases in a certain area, and also in relation to, because of the lockdown, a lot of indigenous, those that are, for example, defending their lands from exploitation or destruction in the past, because of the lockdown, they were not able to monitor, and that was taken advantage of. And they cannot mobilize support. They cannot call anyone like, look, loggers are coming in, miners are coming in to destroy our territories. So the lack of that technology of information for them to get support was really was a big issue. So there were increased cases of human rights violations during the pandemic, in addition, of course, to the number of cases and death that has happened. So it is very, very essential that at this time of crisis, we need interconnectivity in terms of communication and information.
Thanks for that. That's you really touched on like some really, really key points around how the pandemic and the close link to internet access has exacerbated inequalities, have had such huge impact beyond just kind of access to information itself, but resulted in increased human rights violation and also thwarts capacity for human for community response. I think that's really interesting to unpack, and we will go into that a little bit more later, no? So Helani, you do a lot of work around research and evidence building. Research and evidence building to sort of inform policymaking. Learn Asia is both pro-poor and pro-market. And I guess it's really interesting, especially at a time of addressing crisis. In your opinion, how has research worked on the needs of those who are disconnected? How has research supported some of the policy work at this particular moment, given that everything was so fast? No, we really started to like lay down lots of policy responses without thinking through it. But maybe previous work somehow managed to like underpin this. So yeah, and maybe specifically towards education, that would be really great if you can speak to that.
Sure, thanks, Jacques. Yes, I mean, certainly we all rushed into a pandemic and all we really had was evidence from before, as did the policymakers. And particularly when it comes to something like education, I would say it's been quite a mixed bag. Certainly in the global south, it's been a rather poor response, starting with the first lockdown, which has got marginally better, but I wouldn't call much of what's going on education. I think at best, it's some kind of revision of things, and at worst, it's no education. But we did have some of the data that actually could have really helped policymakers, and we have been getting it out there in front of these people. So, I mean, just talk about the simple concept of access. You need to know who has access to what, how much access, so what kind of access, right? So we knew that under 30% of phones were smartphones in a country like India, or most of South Asia for that matter. That has a huge implication of what kind of content you can deliver, what apps can be used in contract tracing, but certainly in education, right? So, but the thing is, this 30% of smartphones is not evenly distributed. There's huge income differences. Socioeconomic group A, the richest group, 60% of households have this. But when you look at socioeconomic group E, the bottom of the pyramid, only about 10% of Indian households went into the pandemic with a working mobile phone and an internet connection. So there's a huge disparity. So that basically meant 50 million Indian households and way more individual people with children went into the pandemic without any kind of connectivity. So what education are we talking about? In some countries, they tried to use radio and TV, often really not in a systematic way to combine proper curricula, but just sort of, you know, putting things out there. But even if you account for households with a radio and an internet and a mobile phone, of a smartphone, still in a country like India, 18 million households went into the pandemic without any of this kind of connectivity, right? So education was really problematic. I pick India, but this data comes from household surveys that has actually been funded by Sida and IDRC, you know, which is really forward thinking, because this is not the kind of data you get from counting SIM cards, because it doesn't tell you anything about who has those SIM cards. So there's also the question, even when you have it, how much access during a government imposed curfew of round sort of the second wave last year, we actually had an e-diary research where we followed people for 14 days using their own phones about what happened. And the number of quotes we get, the one smartphone is owned by the office of the father of this house. The child has to do online learning. And when the child has an online class, the father just says, oh, sir, my signal is not good. I can't join this call. And, you know, doesn't say that the child is using it. So it's not just having a phone, it's how many hours of access you actually have to it. Now, he can legitimately say signal is bad because signal is bad in many of the countries in Africa, Asia, and Latin America, right? So it becomes a legitimate excuse, actually. There's also the issue, even though my quote is about a father, the phone that the mother has is what's often used by the children. So the little access women had, we know there was a 37% gap, for example, in Mozambique and Pakistan, between men and women owning smartphones or any phone. Now that woman has even less access because the child is using the phone, right? And she has sort of, you know, lesser avenues. There's the issue of affordability. Using the ITU and Alliance for Affordable Internet Access, which is the benchmark, which says 1 gigabyte of data has to be at least under 2% of monthly income. Even in a moderately middle-income country like Sri Lanka, that benchmark, it doesn't hold for 60% of the population. So it doesn't meet the affordability standards. In a poorer country like India, Mozambique, many other countries, there are way more people who can't afford that. And we all know 1 gig of internet really doesn't do much these days if you're talking about meaningful digital content. There's also the issue of skill. I mean, there's a fantastic Human Rights Watch report which talks across Africa of the lack of learning and the lack of skill, even on the part of parents, to get their kids online. And we're not even talking about a safe internet experience. We're just talking about just getting somehow online. But if you are to change privacy settings on your phone and have a rights-preserving, privacy-preserving internet experience, people need skill, and that's really lacking. Again, from those surveys, the After Access surveys, in a country like Sri Lanka, we're talking 50% of everyone over the age of 15 know how to change a simple setting on an app. So the situation is not good, right? We were not learning. But also, I mean, the pandemic hitting is too late. The way to integrate ICTs into education is to do it way before. And haven't we been trying to do that for 15, 20 years before by giving tablets? That has really not been integrated into teaching, right? Then you can seamlessly move. So none, you know, sort of policymakers were sort of horribly woken up to these realities. And the pictures of Indonesian, some African country, you know, children, you know, or even in my country, going up to the road or climbing a tree to get signal, right? This is a pathetic situation of not using the evidence that's been in front of our eyes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think it will be really interesting sort of moving forward if this moment of the crisis and how it has really, like, you know, put in front of our faces what it means, right, if you cannot access the internet and what this connection is to education. Maybe this can help to accelerate some of the policy work in this field and also, like, really start to create more resources for research and the kinds of research that you're talking about, which is super critical because there's so many intersecting lens. I mean, Joan was talking about the intersection between Indigenous people and, of course, my own work around gender and also around, like, sexuality and all of these different pieces that need to land in order to kind of address the many dimensions of access. I wonder if we can open it up to participants or, like, you know, if there's any last thought to any of the panelists around how has access featured in your context in terms of COVID-19? And what are some of the key issues on meaningful access that really critically and urgently that needs to be addressed? We can, take some. I can't see the hop in because this is like a very interesting moment. So we have like some things happening in the back end to get some of the comments in, if there's any. But yeah, in case anyone else in the panelists would like to jump in and have a thought around access.
Yeah, can I jump in?
Yeah, sure.
I completely to also mention about the difficulties of women who became more vulnerable to domestic violence and other forms of abuse, and without any facility to communicate, made it even worse for them. And also for land rights defenders, including women. I remember two were killed in Colombia while they were on lockdown because they can be traced where they were, and it was difficult for them to mobilize support, and then it was easier for them to be targeted. That means that infrastructure that you need, right, in a situation where of lockdown, as a person, as a human rights defender, requires better security. Otherwise, you become even more vulnerable to attack.
Yeah, that is a really good point. And that also really resonates with the conversation that was at the pre-SIF to talk about specific challenges that women human rights defenders were facing, not only in terms of like freedom of expression, but really being attacked on the basis of their gender and sexuality. And thanks also for reminding about, yeah, what happens to Indigenous activists, many of whom are women at the leadership, then who are then being very, very vulnerable because contact tracing and surveillance that has now become really the norm, no? Which I guess segues us quite nicely into our second segment, which is really talking about building trust. And at the last SIF, we spoke about a trust deficit when it came to relying on technology infrastructure that is heavily privatized, that is built with profit and data extraction from users as its primary driving force. And we've seen at this time of the pandemic, so many different types of technologies being rolled out to respond and to manage this crisis. I think we've moved away a little bit from the techno-solutionism in the beginning that we were really hoping for a technology silver bullet. Hopefully that's no longer the case, but nonetheless, contact tracing applications, QR codes, tracking wearables, all forms of digital infrastructure has been laid down as a way for us to respond to this situation whilst people are held in lockdown context. So how do we build trust in this scenario? And at a time of a large-scale crisis, so this is a question to Pierre, the state and government has a critical role to coordinate response. So what can governments do to strengthen trust as we ask more and more people to be data subjects? And as an add-on question, how can the government check the power of the private sector who plays a big part in providing technology infrastructure?
Well, I think these are really good questions, and I think to start off with trust or the lack of trust is of course a huge issue, a huge problem in an emergency, and that has been when it's revealed in a response, as in a COVID response or any other response, when that lack of trust is revealed, it's too late. Trust has to be built in a very long-term perspective. So in a pandemic response in a non-connected area where there is a lack of trust to begin with, of course, it's extremely difficult and it needs to be extremely sensitive. And to work, you have to have a bottom-up approach. And we know that's very seldom the case in these contexts specifically. I think initially during the pandemic, Swedish Development Corporation, we allocated financing resources to protect freedom of information, to try to enlarge democratic space, to protect media, civil society's ability to hold decision makers accountable, also in the state of emergency. And we said this is as important as it is to allocate resources to the health sector at this point, because we know what happens in emergencies. And we also, together with Gothenburg University, saw in a report called Pandemic Backsliding, how a lot of countries that were authoritative from the start, but also countries we know as democracies, used undemocratic measures to try to combat the pandemic. But we also see that there's really no effect on the pandemic response itself. It's not more effective to fight the pandemic with non-democratic measures. And as you say, I think we need to learn from this. We need now to understand where we are at and understand that really the way forward here is not to shrink democratic space, offline or online, but to enlarge it, to create environments where people are more participatory, involved in their society building, and therefore also in their responses to different emergencies. Now, states, of course, have an obligation to protect and fulfill human rights online and offline. And it is our responsibility to navigate in this extremely complex landscape of multinational private sector, tech industries, local governments, national governments, and so on. And we need to be able to do so. We don't know how to do so today. We are you know, learning how to navigate in this. And to learn to navigate in this complex map, we are in so much need of civil society organizations, of activists that know things, read things, see things, report on things that we don't. And also to be able to and I'm coming to an end here, but because digital technologies, of course, offer an opportunity. They offer an opportunity for us to more effectively address crisis. I mean, we are now in a project, the Sida is, with the World Bank and UNICEF, on how we can make sure that COVID vaccines can be traced and verified and reduce the risks of falsified medicines or corruption in this response. Extremely important. And we can use that and do that only with this new technology. But, you know, I am very, I mean, we see this same technology being misused for civilians, for silencing of defenders of human rights or the environment. And I think here also we must also be ready to train or to make available training also to people who use this type of technology so they can know how to use them and still protect themselves. I mean, personally, I don't know what all the texts that I need to okay when I, you know, download a new app, what all that text means and where I send and sell my information. I try to be good at that. And if I can't do it, then, you know, in my privileged positions, then of course out there in the world, when we're struggling to get people connected, that type of information is going to get lost. So technology is an opportunity, but without transparency, accountability, media freedom, space for civil society, it will be a great challenge to ask for people's trust in their government, in their multinationals, you know, whenever they, and so they can protect their integrity and still be use the internet and use the technology at its best. So this is a huge challenge, and it's a challenge to us as states, because it is, in the end, our responsibility to protect and promote human rights offline and online.
Yeah, great. I mean, thanks so much for sort of like also introducing the term of pandemic. I mean, introducing to this conversation the term of pandemic backsliding. Actually, that has been the reality in many different contexts. And I also really appreciate the need to kind of resource and create more participatory spaces as a way to build trust. It's kind of like opening it up and resourcing it as an equally critical moment at this point. And I know that digital security and safety is going to be a huge conversation at SIF as well, so that we can carry through some of this conversation in those moments. So I'm really glad that that's also introduced at this particular juncture. And Irene, I guess like what Kira was talking about, the complexity of engagements between different stakeholders, different actors in different sectors. And this is maybe never more evident in the situation of disinformation, because you have all this information that's created and disseminated and circulated across all of our different media spaces, and private sector has a, as you know, particularly social media platforms have a big role to play in this. From where I stand, government seems to have had a very heavy-handed response, creating, you know, very broad laws that consolidate power to increase state control. So, share, like, you know, what's your opinion in all of this? I know you've recently done a report on this as well. So it'd be really great to hear, like, what are some potential ways forward, some key insights? Yeah. You're muted.
Yeah. Oh, thank you. Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity to join the conversation. I think you put your finger on the issue by raising the issue of trust, because there is a lack of trust in institutions and in information. People don't know what to trust anymore. And that is, of course, as Special Rapporteur for Freedom of Expression and Opinion, for me, that's a toxin in my mandate, if I can put it that way. That's introducing poison into this right. Now, the One important thing, the starting point, I think, should be to recognize human rights as not part of the problem, but as part of the solution. The objective should be to protect rights, protect the right of freedom of expression, opinion, privacy, right to assemble and participate in public life. But unfortunately, we've talked about responses of states have been problematic, but responses of companies have equally been inadequate. So that combination, I think, is something that we need to resist. Per talked about multilateral responses. I would go one step forward and talk about multi-stakeholder responses. We need to move into multi-stakeholderism in this area. Now, too often, governments tend themselves to be a source of disinformation, and I think we should be brave enough to confront that. Also, governments take blunt instruments, for example, internet shutdown. If you shut down the internet in order to stop disinformation, what you're doing is you're killing all sources of information, and rumors then start flourishing. So it's actually counterproductive. And very often, of course, we have seen a whole spate of so-called false news laws coming. I think there were something like 22 laws in last year alone as an attempt to address misinformation and disinformation, but very often they were overly broad, vague, and the whole idea was actually to introduce censorship of state criticism. Whenever there was criticism on the way in which governments were handling the pandemic, then this, it was fake news. So that those kinds of practices have to stop. You know, that would be my first point. Then I think states, of course, have a duty to ensure that companies are respecting human rights. And state regulation should not seek to censor speech online, speech that is legitimate under international human rights law, and they should not collude with platforms or put pressure on platforms to cooperate with them on restricting legitimate speech, because that, again, destroys trust. State regulation of social media should focus on transparency, on due process rights, on due diligence of human rights, not on content moderation when that content moderation would violate human rights. Now, data protection is a very important responsibility of the state, and I emphasize that because much of what we see in social media platforms, for example, is using the data to create more problem because they're basically data mining for their ad-driven models. And there, the state has a very big responsibility to protect data and protect people's right to privacy. Now, we've talked also, and then another very important responsibility, diverse, independent, pluralistic media. That is a powerful antidote to mistrust. And yet, that is what has been hit hard during the pandemic. Even in, for example, I was just reading in the news this morning about the hundreds of journalists who have been, who have died in India of COVID-19, because they're at the front line, they're going out to collect news, but they're not considered to be essential workers, so they're not getting any vaccinations. So it's not even an overt policy of attacking journalists, but this kind of indirect way in which journalism and media has been attacked. On the other side, I would say people need to be empowered. And that is where media information and digital literacy comes in. Users, you know, in the digital world, people are seen as users, not as rights holders. And I think that is a very shift, big shift of the mindset that is needed there. As far as companies are concerned, particularly the large social media companies, have, of course, tried to introduce various measures to improve content moderation, on, especially related to the pandemic. However, what they haven't done, and I think it's time that governments got onto that, is look at their own business model. The problem lies with that business model, which lacks transparency, which is based on data, which is actually, the whole idea is to keep you engaged with provocative material on the platforms for as long as possible so that they can get the data they need to build their profit, yeah. profit model. model. So I think one needs to get to the heart of those problems. And I'm just going to, and that is where transparency and accountability comes in, as Per was saying. So what I would basically say, and one final point, gender disinformation. I think there needs a gender lens to be put into this whole area. And we would find out that, as Helani was saying earlier, that there is so much information out there that we haven't grappled with. And that's a serious problem that I think is also becoming evident in the pandemic. So at the end of the day, I would say it requires all parts of society, media, civil society, governments, and companies to work together. And that's where I think the digital cooperation should be different from the kind of cooperation we've had before. So if we are building back better, we must take the multi-stakeholder route.
Yeah, I really appreciate like sort of bringing in multi-stakeholder engagement into the conversation, and you really introduce like a plethora of different kinds of like, you know, principles and processes that could be critical. I just want to especially pause and highlight like absolutely we really need legal safeguards on data protection. So many of countries have really laid down infrastructure, laid down technology without laying down legal protection or legal framework and safeguards. And that's like, I don't know where that's going to take us in 2 years, but not a good place. And thanks also for ending on, of course, needing a strong gender lens in looking at this issue. And I think the question around the gaps around literacy and digital literacy is also being raised in the chat. I'm seeing some comments there about, like, you know, the disparity in access really being felt in places like Cameroon. And also Alison spoke about how this is really being experienced differently in Africa as well. I wonder if there is responses about the question on how we may want to build trust. And we'll leave that question open to the participant for now and maybe come back to it if there are more responses. And maybe also following up to that question, opening up to participants, which is sort of like our next segment, like against all odds, and maybe because of everything, because crisis makes, you know, disparities so acute and like you just can't take it anymore. 2020 and 2021 has been a year of protests. We have really witnessed the incredible resilience unfolding, how people organized on the ground. They've been so quick in really responding when states were slow to provide kind of really urgent community response to specific communities. But also, also people coming out on the streets, and so much of this happened throughout 2020. And technology plays such a critical role here, but maybe more so than sort of when we think about technology and we think about technology infrastructure. And I think, Joan, you alluded to it a little bit earlier, talking about actually it's about communities having systems in place, already sort of, you know, engaging and communicating with each other. So it's really like it's about infrastructure of people, platforms and processes, right? Just to name a few. So what do we need, Joan? Question of resilience. What do we need to build stronger relationships between communities? So how has solidarity action looked like in terms of not only for Indigenous peoples during this time and in terms of activism, but also in between? And what sorts of infrastructure do we need in that kind of expansive look?
Let me start by sharing the experience in the Philippines. As you know, one of the main impact of COVID is hunger, especially among the poor people. And a lot were not able to have work. So there's really a lot of people in hunger situation. So one selfless lady started a community pantry where she put food items, like a small stall in front of her house with food items, and those in need can get food, and the others who have something to share can put that in the community pantry. So the motto of the community pantry was to give according to your ability and to take according to your need. And so when that was presented in social media, it suddenly mushroomed all over the country. And those that are giving food are even the poor people sharing whatever they have. The farmers who are producing vegetables are sharing the vegetables that they produce. So it suddenly erupted into a movement of hope in this pandemic. So it really shows that we still have that sense of solidarity, that sense of cooperation, and that is what we need in terms of our social relations, but also to respect diversity and respect, you know, in have a respectful relations with each other that is based on care and giving. And because the pandemic hits everybody, but those that are most in need needs the support, needs our assistance because of the existing inequality. So that is, and the principle behind this community pantry in the Philippines is a very much an integral part of indigenous people's values, our values of sharing the common good. We have a word for that even in our language. That you don't when you produce something, you produce your food, you produce something to share, not just for your own. And that is a very special value of relations, that what you do to others may reflect on you. So if you do bad things will also happen to you. So you always think of doing something good so that you will also receive something good. And that is the spirit of sharing and the spirit of cooperation in times of crisis. That has always been what our culture, and that's why a lot of indigenous peoples are resilient, because of that link, that interrelations that we have. That I know that if I go hungry, my neighbor is going to give me food. It gives you that sense of comfort because of that shared value. So I think that's a very important thing. And the other one is, we also have this word called kasyana, that we need to collectively find means to cope and rise up and not to give up. And that's exactly the spirit behind the community pantries that gave hope to a lot of people. So now, what kind of technology that we need? In this situation, it has already mentioned that we need an open access, that everybody, it's a right for everybody to have access. That as already mentioned, that should not be a privilege. It should be a right. And that should be open and free, because also digital, if it's controlled, then it's again can be used, especially those against the powerless people. Now, in terms of the how we can develop the question on solidarity action, how it looks like in this time, the digital platform has played a critical role. I'll give you two examples. The remote communities in Russia struggling against the environmental mess created a mining company in this time of COVID, requested for support. And we came out with a petition, public petition for solidarity. And so many people signed up to show solidarity. The same with those in Indonesia when they were arrested in protesting the expansion of a palm oil. We again mobilized support using the digital platform, sharing the pictures, what's happening. And that has really raised attention to these cases happening under the pandemic and mobilizing people to say enough is enough. So it's a very critical role at this time. At the same time, it's also being used against human rights defenders. In the Philippines, those that are opposing the government are suddenly tagged as terrorists through social media. One of my colleagues was a woman leader, was accused as a mistress through social media to discredit. So it's also used against the movement. So we also need to be vigilant when this platform is also used. Instead of building solidarity, instead of building cooperation, it's also used to discredit or to malign or isolate even activists and human rights defenders. So so that is the dimension we also need to be aware of.
It also reminds me of what Irene was just saying about sometimes the government is the source of misinformation. And I think that was a report that came out maybe early this year that was really looking at sort of, you know, how much in the government's budget, speaking about research, was actually put into trying to control discourse online. And it's like surprisingly many governments engage in this. And there is also definitely a specific sort of gender dimension to it. And there's like some feedback that's come in on Twitter as well, on building trust. It really requires time, and that multi-stakeholder processes are really central to establishing the kinds of inclusive, participatory and effective responses at all different levels. Really critical to think about democratic processes and strengthening that. And there's also a comment from Twitter that says, well, what can governments do? Because 54% of humanity does not live in democratic nations, and many governments are really not that interested in building trust. On the contrary, some actively using the internet to spread mistrust, which is a reality for some of us, for many of us, actually. And I guess as a follow-up question to Irene, at this year as well, we've seen a lot of internet shutdowns as a way to kind of respond to the situation of elections or protests or any sort of way. And I think the shutdown has a far greater repercussion at this point when the internet has been so significant and instrumental as a space for communication. So how do we defend the internet as a public infrastructure and as a critical public space?
Well, shutting down the internet is really about shutting up critics. And this kind of sweeping measure we've seen is in some cases, particularly for minorities, isolated communities and so on, it's collective punishment when the internet is shut down, because the internet is used for so many different purposes, from healthcare to banking services to everything that we do. Even this conference would not have been possible under the circumstances had it not been for the internet. And there, I think something interesting is happening, and I think those governments that want to have open, free, interoperable internet can support. And that is, we see at the international level a growing understanding that internet shutdowns are a violation of international human rights law, because they're such a blunt instrument and deprive people of so many rights and services. There have been resolutions of the Human Rights Council. There has been growing understanding also at the UN General Assembly. And I think it's very important to build on that and create an international norm that internet shutdown is unlawful. You would not dream of shutting down water supply to a community, because that would be considered to be a severe violation of international law. International human rights law. In the same way, I think governments should keep pressing until there is this strong international norm on internet shutdowns, because that can then be used to put pressure on those governments that still shut down the internet just before elections, for example, or when protests are being arranged, for example, right now in Myanmar or in Colombia or other countries. That's actually happening right now. That's the first thing. The second thing is, of course, companies. Companies have obligations to respect and protect human rights, telecom companies and ICT companies, who are actually responding to government orders to shut down the internet. They need to uphold human rights, which means they should not simply respond to a government request. They need to demand whether that request is backed by law. And what we find very interesting is that in some of these countries where the governments are seeking internet shutdowns, the courts are resisting it. If you look at India, the Indian government shut down the internet in Kashmir for a very long period. It was the Indian court that gave an order saying you can't do that. So there are domestic legal systems that can be used, and companies should actually insist on that. Companies should also be transparent and reveal who is asking for internet orders to be shut down. For example, Telenor in Myanmar was actually publishing these orders until recently, but I think they have now stopped because of fear of their own safety. But I think there needs to be more transparency. The law has to be used, and the international law has to be strengthened.
Yeah, thanks. That's really, really good point, actually, to talk about kind of the power of the courts also as a form of check and balance. And I really like this kind of thinking about, well, internet is like water, maybe, as a form of like public good. So how do we then think about the regulation of internet like water, and what would that mean, and how would that look like? I guess then that sort of takes us quite nicely into our last segment, which is looking at resilience, environment, and the economy. And a question to Pierre. So a key challenge in this particular crisis is really the economic impact and perhaps the urgency and opportunity for comprehensive digital transformation approaches. And at the same time, the pandemic may have accelerated conversations around sustainable digital economies. So can you say a little bit more about how Sweden is approaching digitalization in this, in development cooperation?
Well, thank you. Yeah, it's just, again, I just want to say how interesting it is to listen to my fellow panelists. There's so many important messages coming from your statements. So it's such a privilege to join you in this conversation. Well, we are including tech and online environments in more programs than ever before in development cooperation. And I expect that to continue. Trying to be part of both, I mean, SIF is one example of how we, through Swedish Development Cooperation, can create these platforms for this type of discussions that can hopefully move policy forward, but also, you know, then using tech in the way we roll out programs or responses. The fact that you can get cash transfers to women through their cell phone, you know, it makes sure that we know that the right person is getting the right amount of support. Their husbands are not, you know, taking charge of that money, but it goes to the woman in the family, and we know that we can then follow up how that's being used, and we can lower the risks of corruption and so on. So using technology also, but you know, we need to push for that more, make sure that more people are connected and have access to the internet, of course. And we've heard many things about that during this discussion. I think, you know, technology, the digital technology and the digital transformation is a, you know, it's a fact. It will continue. So we need to have this conversation on how do we then utilize its potential for, you know, sustainable economic development to combat climate change. I spoke with two scientists last week that work with Earth observations. So techniques from NASA, how do you use that to empower, for example, indigenous communities to take action and on their own land and for their land rights, for example. And this is extremely interesting. But then we come back to the fact that we need to be connected. So there's so many ways of doing this. We work for a future where digital technology promotes inclusive growth, that it fosters resilient societies, and that includes, of course, the most vulnerable, those furthest left behind in this. We use digital technology across all of our development work to accelerate development and then increase, of course, the effectiveness of the assistance. But I don't know, can I just come back to the fact that of this multilateral or this cooperation. I think the Secretary General of the UN talks about it as we need a connected and networked multilateralism that is multi-stakeholder. And I think in the discussions that we are having now, it's really evident how that is being, how we have to have exactly that, because it is very complex. I think, you know, how to build trust, coming back to that, I think the algorithms, at least this is my personal experience, algorithms today drive mistrust more than they drive trust. Even if I want to use social media and technology to build trust, to increase understanding, what I get back is mistrust and conflict instead of understanding and maybe joint ways forward. And sometimes it seems like tech industry is serving the authoritative regimes more than the democratic regimes. But of course, this is how we use it. So if we can together work on all these different levels to push a more democratic direction for the world as such, then of course technology and algorithms and all of this will also follow when we reach a tipping point that is positive in all of this. And to us, for us to reach there, all of us need to push where we are at a little by little. And then, you know, don't run away from these types of conversations that are very hard and complex, but we need to have them. So this is where I think, and I want Swedish Development Corporation to push for this, to push against and for this tipping point where all actors involved together are able to turn this development, this technology into something that is good for us, that is positive for our space, for our freedoms, and not negative for them.
Yeah, there's so much actually to kind of like discuss in this particular topic as well, kind of like, you know, the different types of, you know, multilateral, multi-stakeholder sorts of collaboration that we could have. What does sustainable mean? Are we trying to build sustainable technology? Do we build towards efficiency or sufficiency, which is also the other thing that's been brought forward? Like, do we need to have efficient economies all the time, or is sufficient enough? And how much of technology is really driving many of this? And one thing that came from 2020, I think, is really we all also just kind of sat with the environmental impact of digital tech a lot more than before. And I'm very, like, you know, I'm pretty sure many are also very excited to see how this SIF will be a space for us to discuss this and see what can we do as we build towards resilience in the future. And before we end, I think, like, last question towards Helani, I really wanted to bring this because also the Pierre was talking about algorithms and how algorithms is like driving so much of this. And the people who's driving and building and developing algorithms that we use are the private sector. And recently I read this paper, which is about let's defund big tech and put funding to communities, because much of technology development is being built in billions and billions of dollars being run by very small corporations. So who should fund technology infrastructure? And I have a personal stake in this question because, as I said earlier in my introduction, trying to co-dream up the first ever dedicated fund for feminist tech that's led by the Global South. So who should fund technology? Technology that's sustainable, resilient, rights protecting. What a big question.
Was that for me, Jacques?
Well, I guess it's for you or open up to anyone. Yeah. Who should fund tech? I guess, yeah, it's an open question. How do we fund technology that is like technology infrastructure, that is all of these things that we're trying to do? Because it is a big part of the question.
Well, maybe just a short, I mean, because this is, when you work in development cooperation, that is always the tricky question, because everything that is needed that is good, we cannot fund with ODA or development money. But what we can do with development is that we can de-risk some investments in, for example, infrastructure or technology and so on. And this is interesting. I mean, is there a technology development that is needed, but since it's just, you know, for good, there's not much, you know, economic gains in that investments. Do we need to de-risk it for it to happen or to reach, you know, those most vulnerable? And that is a discussion to have, I think, within development cooperation. Is there a space that we need to de-risk so that the capital or the investments are being directed to the sustainability in this and not to work something else? And I think that's a good conversation to have.
So conversation about de-risking. I see a hand by Helani and also Irene. So Helani, do you want to go ahead first?
Yeah, I mean, I think of this, you know, everyone thought the internet was going to be a great thing and there was going to be positive economic externalities. And therefore, many companies got tax breaks because that is what you do when there are positive externalities, you encourage it. Now we are at the stage when finally there's recognition of some, and it has been a great boon to countries which would not have otherwise been able to make that public infrastructure investment. So I think we need to recognize that role played by private money. It's significant, it has changed many lives for the better. But now we are talking about a lot of the problems and the negative externalities. And the negative externalities, economic theory would say, well, you need to change the provider behavior and financial constraints and non-financial constraints. So we've talked a lot about the non-financial. That's about the regulation and the governance infrastructures, right? Which is about thinking, creating the data protection, privacy protection regimes, the algorithmic transparency and accountability regimes at national and international level that is not only privacy preserving, but also innovation enhancing. So it has a lot to do with level playing field and who has access to data and so on, right? That's one conversation that has to be had. Then there are the financial tools, and economics says, well, then you tax it, and then you use that tax money to sort out the problems, the negative externalities. Now, we know there's the fundamental problem of tax. Now, negative externalities implies you overtax them above other sectors. But in digital, we have a problem where even the regular tax is not paid by the big giant. So there's a fundamental problem there. Then there's the problem of taxing to actually reduce the negative externalities. We're not even close to that, right? Now, I know there are discussions and things being tried out and sort of coming down the line. The G20 and OECD are talking about a global digital taxation regime. Many other countries have already sort of their own transaction-based taxation. So Australia has a 10% tax on, I think, non-residential providers of electronic goods and services, a lot of these cross-border issues. India has a tax on like something called the equalization.
I have to interrupt you there, because we're running a little bit out of time. So that's last fine. Point to wrap it up.
So yeah. I think my last point is that even if we manage to tax them, which is a difficulty, even if we have to figure out how to actually get this money to developing countries, even if we figure that out, the societal contract on what our governments do with that new tax revenue is really problematic, right? Are they going to spend it on improving the environment, building alternate tech platforms that are civil society and government owned, for example, or is it going to go into pockets of politicians? So that in the absence of democracy, rule of law, and transparency, even if we get the money, I'm really not sure what countries will do with it.
So basically, funding is a lot more than just money. Funding is basically also strengthening the ecosystem around technology development for everything. Makes sense. Irene, I know you wanted to jump into this specifically, but since we're wrapping, just one last question to everybody before we wrap is, I guess, one last thought about technology's role in building resilience. Keep it pretty short. We have about 2 minutes. So, yeah, Irene, let's start with you.
Well, I'll keep it very short. I think we shouldn't forget the offline as we start talking about the online. Offline is about people. And this is all about empowering citizens, empowering individuals, empowering people. And that is where I think we need to put more attention, whether it's by giving people more control over social media, whether it's making issues more transparent, whether it's digital literacy, whether it's investing in the media, sources of information. It's about investing in people and their rights.
Sorry, I'm like taking precious time to pause. That's really great. I really like, right to the heart of it. Helani, do you want like, you just went, no? My brain is like, Joan, would you like to go next?
Yeah, I certainly agree that it should be empowering communities and also in ensuring always the common good and the public interest over any other kind of interest that we need, and supporting community-based resilience actions, because that's where we need more action, especially among those marginalized and vulnerable groups. They should always be the center of action to build resilience, to equal the power. Thank you.
Yeah, more power to that community resilience, absolutely. Pierre?
So many things have been said. There's not much to add, I think, from my side, but I mean, technology, again, provides us with great opportunities for democratization and development, for resilience. If it can increase accountability and access to information and therefore enjoyment of human rights. And I think, again, an informed society is a strong society. So, but we must, of course, then work together to ensure that everyone is given the same opportunity to access access technologies, internet, and therefore access to these rights. Thank you.
Fantastic. And Helani, last word to you.
We have a rare chance to come out of this really dark period and build back better. Technology can either take us forward to a better future or not. So it's really up to the people in this forum and around us to do that.
Oh, thank you. What a great last statement. We do have this rare chance to build back better. So that concludes our opening panel. Thank you very much to all of our discussants for this really, really interesting insights and thoughts. Thank you also to the comments that's been placed on Twitter and on the chat. I'm sorry we weren't able to speak about some of the protest examples that were being given. But this is really just the beginning. Really looking forward to more conversations with everybody. Please hang out in the Hangout open board as well at the clinic so that we can continue to build back better and to build community resilience. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.